Good evening, everybody. Welcome to another edition of the Residence Smart Learning Program. Today we have amidst us Dr. Ganesh Pakshi, who is a reputed uro-oncologist at the Tata Memorial Hospital, who will be talking to us on common urinary diversion, which is a very important topic for the residents to know. And we have set out his learning objectives for that. I would request all the residents to log in now and listen to his lecture. Over to Dr. Rajiv Sood for his opening remarks, and then we hand it over to Dr. Arun Chawla for the introduction. Over to you, Dr. Rajiv Sood.
Thank you, Dr. Keshav. Today is another episode of our distant learning program. And Dr. Ganesh Pakshi is going to speak. He's an eminent uro-oncologist and also a great teacher. And as has been introduced already, the topic is very much relevant for our theory exam residents, for the practical approach in the clinics, and also that the urinary diversions, they are the backbone of reconstructive urology and is greatly practiced, and the teaching and the learning of various techniques very important. If you see that it is mentioned in our standard textbooks also, that for each reconstruction or each urinary diversion, there is a technique, there is an evolution, and there has been 200 plus urinary diversion techniques, but very few are mastered and practiced by individuals. So it is individualized, it is also innovative approach where new techniques have been introduced to already practiced techniques are also, there are diversion, there are undiversions also, and there are continent in, and there are incontinent diversions, which can be interconverted also. So Dr. Ganesh Pakshi is going to benefit all the residents, and I'll request all the residents to make it a very, very interactive session and learn as much as they can, so that they can be benefited in their urological practice, in their exams, in their practical, when the operative procedures are asked. And all the best. And back to Dr. Keshav Murthy.
Thank you, Professor Sood. I would now request Dr. Arun Chawla to introduce Dr. Ganesh Pakshi and the topic. Over to you, Dr. Arun.
Thank you, Dr. Keshav. Dr. Ganesh Pakshi is a professor and consultant uro-oncologist based at Tata Memorial Cancer Hospital, Mumbai. He has been associated with many renowned uro-oncologists back in his hospital. And with an opportunity to work with senior uro-oncologists like Professor Jagdish Kulkarni, Professor Hemanthan Gaonkar, Dr. Yuvraj, he has distinguished himself into a very skilled and very competent uro-oncologist. Little bit brief about his preliminary training and experience. He has got many awards and honors during his undergraduate and postgraduate training in Mumbai. He has been a reviewer for many cancer journals, both the national as the international journals. And he himself has authored many publications in the area of uro-oncology in Q1 and Q2 journals. And very often he is invited as faculty to various uro-oncology meetings, both in India as well as abroad. We are very happy to have him for today's lecture on common urinary diversions. And for the resident, it's very important. This subject is important to have a basic overall knowledge related to the urinary diversions, which are commonly performed. This surely comes in some form or another as a note in one of the four papers of urology. I remember that when I was seeing the last 10-year papers during our time, undiversions, ileal conduit, the paired type of diversion, Ledbetter, Politburn, Nesbitt, Condonier, these types of questions used to rotate in some form or another during the our preparation for the MCH. So I just request you to just listen to him properly. And why this is important is because today's quiz is based on what he'll be talking, which opens at 8:25 p.m. For you to, which is important for the awards and the rewards. With this, I again welcome Dr. Ganesh Bakshi for today's lecture. And over to you, Dr. Ganesh.
Thank you so much, sir, for the kind introduction. And I thank USISU for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, Dr. Keshav Murthy, sir, and Rajiv Sood, sir. I've just shared the presentation. So this is the topic for the day. Good evening to all. And as Dr. Arun Chawla, sir, said, being working here in Tata Memorial Hospital, I really had the pleasure to know Dr. Kamath, sir, who was here, Dr. Murli Kamath, and had the pleasant opportunity of working with Dr. Jagdish Kulkarni and Dr. Hemant Tongaonkar, sir, also. So what I do in practice about this is what I've imbibed and what I've learned over the years. So going ahead with this topic, the learning objectives, this is a slightly long list, but also we have a good time today. So basically, this surgery is most commonly done, I would say, after a cystectomy. And these are the rough goals in a cystectomy. The topic is not cystectomy today. Coming to the definition, a urinary divergent is defined as the surgical creation of an alternate route of flow for urine to replace an absent or diseased portion of the lower urinary tract in order to preserve renal function and achieve other goals as in cancer. So, commonest indication is bladder cancer. Others would be trauma, refractory incontinence in some cases, overactive bladder, congenital abnormalities like ectopia vesicae, spinal cord injury, interstitial and radiation cystitis. Coming to a very brief history, because the topic is like that, you should know some history. Like uretrosigmoidostomy was first form of continent diversion reported by Simon in 1852. And that was done for bladder extrophy. And these complications were seen. And ileal conduit was described by Bricker in 1950. And it has still been a very good gold standard for urinary diversion. This is the other history, like 1851, Simon had put a ureteroproctostomy, and 1852 again, sigmoidostomy, 1898, rectal bladder, and so on, till 1959, ileal neobladder was described by Kami, and in early 1980s, Indiana pouch was very famous, and then slightly it went down, and late 1980s, the orthotopic diversion came into the picture. Now, one or two slides about Eugene Bricker, who had popularized the ileal conduit, which many people in the world do today. That was in 1950, a landmark paper published on his experience in surgical clinics of North America. And this was actually whom we see as Eugene Bricker. So he, at that time, when it was published in 1995, he had written that we ourselves are so pleased with this procedure that we would probably not go in for any kind of pouch or something. Coming to the types of urinary diversion. So non-continent, which is an ileal conduit or a cutaneous ureterostomy. Continent divergent, which are of two types, heterotopic and orthotopic. So heterotopic, we can have cutaneous continent catheterizable urinary reservoir. Divergent or divergent to the GI tract. Orthotopic is some form of the various neobladders. So now we take this topic of common urinary diversion in steps, as I had outlined in the first slide, about the bowel segments. Now the choice of bowel segments historically has been stomach also. Advantages in renal failure, less permeable to urinary solutes. There is a net excretion of chlorides and protons rather than a net absorption, produces less mucus and less bacteriuria. The next and the commonest, and by choice, the one which we use is ileum. Nutritional problems can happen because of lack of vitamin B12 absorption, diarrhea because of lack of bile salt reabsorption and fat malabsorption. And in some postoperative bowel, obstruction rate up to 10% is seen. The next segment used is colon. So postoperative bowel obstruction with colon has been seen up to 4%. Both ileal and colon segments, the same type of electrolyte imbalance is usually seen. An anti-reflux ureterointerstitial anastomosis by submucosal tunnel technique is easier to perform with colon. So if you go on intestinal anastomosis, we require a segment of the intestine. Hence, an intestinal anastomosis is a part of this surgery. The first principle is adequate exposure. The second principle is to maintain a good blood supply to the severed ends of the bowel. The third principle involves prevention of local spillage of enteric contents. The fourth principle, an accurate apposition of serosa to serosa of the two segments of bowel to be anastomosed. Fifth is not to tie the sutures so tight so as to strangulate or necrose the area in between. And the final principle involves realignment of the mesentery of the two segments of the bowel to be joined. So now complications related to the intestinal anastomosis. It can be a fecal fistula, first few weeks, 4 to 5%. Infection, pelvic abscess, sepsis, and bowel obstruction. So ileum 10%, colon 5%, 50% present in early postoperative period, and causes can be adhesions, volvulus, internal hernia, or maybe some disease leftover recurrence. Surgical means to reduce this kind of bowel obstruction using a non-irradiated bowel. Some of the patients in cancer are radiated, or some might have history of prior radiation for something. Performing the anastomosis on well-vascularized bowel, closing all apertures, retroperitonealizing the isolated segment, lateralizing the conduit, reperitonealization of the pelvis, decompressing the GI tract for an adequate time, placing omentum over the anastomosis, and reconstituting the pelvic floor after excentrative surgery. We just finished the kind of explanation for bowel anastomosis, and coming to the ureterointestinal anastomosis. So the principles here are optimal mobilization of the ureter, no redundancy tension on the anastomosis, that much length of mobilization, preserve maximum peri-adventitial tissue, performed with fine absorbable sutures, so watertight mucosa to mucosa apposition. The bowel should be pulled to the ureter rather than the other way around. If possible, the anastomosis should be retroperitonealized. The flap of peritoneum should be put over it. Describe type of anastomosis, ureterointestinal. If you see a ureterocolonic and ureteroileal, we have non-refluxing and refluxing. What happens most commonly is ureteroileal. Hence, I have highlighted that. And refluxing is done little more commonly. So, Bricker and Wallace technique is the one. Coming to the Bricker's anastomosis, if we see a small full thickness serosal and mucosal plug is removed, actually cut with a scissors from the bowel, and interrupted 5-OPDS sutures approximate the ureter to the full thickness of the mucosa and serosa. Many people don't take a second layer, but many people also take a second layer, which is through the adventitia of the ureter, mind you, not the actual thickness of the ureter, into the peri-adventitial fat and the serosa of the small bowel. So this just buries the first layer. Coming to the Wallace anastomosis, both ureters are spatulated and laid adjacent to each other as shown here. So they can be side by side or head to tail like head to tail position. And the apex of one ureter is sutured to the apex of the other ureter with PDS 5-0. The posterior medial walls are then sutured together. And the lateral walls, this hole is sutured to the ileal end, which is open. So this is how two types of Wallace's anastomosis is made. Coming to complications of uretero-intestinal anastomosis. The first or probably the most feared is a leak, 5 to 10% occur during the first 7 to 10 days. Management includes urinary diversion in the form of bilateral PCNs or surgical revision. Now, this depends on how small or big is the leak. And if you see the second complication, anastomotic stricture. So anti-refluxing techniques have a slightly higher incidence and cause can be ischemia, irradiated tissues, or infection. If you see the management protocol for ureteroenteric anastomotic strictures, we should assess the length of these and the renal function. If it is less than 2 centimeters and a good renal function, on the right side, we can try endoscopic, but on the left side, it is difficult, sometimes through the sigmoid tunnel, or it is less maneuverability. So consider formal repair. And if the stricture is more than 2 centimeters and the function is good, we have to do a formal repair. Otherwise, if the function is very less, then you need to do a nephrectomy. complications again of the ureterointestinal anastomosis. If you see the colon and the small bowel, the stricture rate is quite higher with the non-reflexing types. However, the leakage rate is quite comparable. One small thing about the left ureter, it is slightly more vulnerable when you cross it under the sigmoid mesentery. In case there is some kind of bleeding or clippings, which you have to do many of these times, the hematomas heal into the fibrosis, which may encrust or entail the ureter. And encasing the ureter, it might further cause fibrosis of the ureter also. So coming to the Pricker's versus Wallace anastomosis, what is preferred? So the type of anastomosis is a matter of surgeon preference. In a meta-analysis, where four studies were there with 658 total patients included in these four studies, the rate of stricture development was 2.9% with the Pricker's versus 1.9% with the Wallace. Difference was not significant. If you see the forest plot also, and no difference in the time to stricture development. Generally, we have a pre-operative optimization of a patient whom we are planning for a urinary diversion. I mean, of any of such a patient with whatever may be the indication to go for a urinary diversion. So since this is the most common indication, counseling about the procedure which is before the urinary diversion, interaction with a designated stoma nursing staff and marking of the optimal site for the cutaneous stoma, nutritional optimization, chest physiotherapy and breathing exercises, and allow patient and family to explore feelings and begin to cope with changes. Coming to the ileal conduit. So here, the site of stoma. The stoma is usually positioned at a point one-third to halfway along a line from the umbilicus to the anterior superior iliac spine. The diagrammatic representation shows that. How to choose the location? Again, also evaluate the patient in various body positions, standing, sitting, reclining, preferably in the right lower quadrant, unencumbered by skin folds, scars, and clothing waistband, away from bony prominences because we have to put a device there. It should accommodate a flush fitting appliance, and it's usually marked with an indelible pen. So patient usually equates the success of stoma with the success of our surgery. And he has to live with that stoma for absolutely his life. So shortly, I do have videos in the end, but I would cover these steps here also. A disc of skin and a subcutaneous fat is excised. Horizontal and vertical incision in the anterior rectus sheath. A rectus muscle split divided. Opening of the posterior sheath and parietal peritoneum. The opening should be snug but not tight. Taking care of the inferior epigastric artery within muscle, delivery of the ileal stump, avoid rotation, fixation to the rectal sheath. There is a small spout. So these are the diagrammatic things of the stoma. The rectus sheath being cut here. And the spout is created by Evergen maneuver. Four seromuscular bites of proximal bowel taken during the skin mucosal opposition, avoiding injury to one side where the mesentery is. Stoma ideally faces a little downwards, and skin mucosal apposition with interrupted absorbable sutures is done. So overall, it looks like this. In post-operative care, we ensure a good urine output so that mucus does not cause a problem. We do put a Foley catheter for a few days. Ileal conduit stoma edema will begin to subside within 7 days after surgery and continue to decrease in size gradually over the next 6 to 8 weeks, after which the stoma might appear a little flush. Elderly and patients with limited manual dexterity may need some assistance. Pre-discharge stoma clinic visit to learn stoma care is important. And patients need to know where to purchase supplies, emergency telephone numbers, ostomy support group information, follow-up appointments with the nurse as well as the doctor. Adaptation or patient adapting to the stoma. So it's a gradual process. Patient experiences grief over the loss of body part and alteration in body image. Adjustment period is individualized. Patients are concerned about body image, sexual activity, family responsibilities, and changes in the lifestyle. The skin area around the pouch needs to be cleaned with a wet towel or washcloth as the pouch is being changed. The skin needs to dry completely before a new pouch is applied. Protective skin wipes or ostomy powder designed to protect the skin can also be used. Complications with a conduit. We have already discussed the bowel related complications that would be common to all types of divergence, but these are related to stoma. Early complications would be ischemia, hemorrhage, retraction, and some technical issues. Late complications would be prolapse, obstruction, hernia, and skin irritation. Complication due to poor technique and poor care and management could also be due to recurrent disease. We have taken a few complications one by one. So stoma, ischemia, or necrosis, 2.3 to 10%, ranges from harmless mucosal sloughing to frank necrosis. Causes are aggressive stripping of mesentery, stenotic fascia defect, extensive tension on the conduit. We need to assess the depth of the necrosis, and necrosis beyond the facial defect warrants immediate reconstruction by another procedure. Stomal hemorrhage. So mild hemorrhage is common and self-limiting. Usually mucosal, we can apply pressure and usually get off. If there is active bleeding, that means there is some mesenteric vessel which is bleeding. We have to identify it and ligate it. Stomal stenosis, as shown in this picture. So 2 to 14% incidence could manifest early or late. Ischemia is usual underlying factor. Other causes would be infection and retraction. We can treat initially with dilation. Otherwise, definitive would be a stoma revision. Mucocutaneous separation, as shown in that picture. Separation along mucocutaneous border, as we see it, occurs to some extent in many patients, caused by underlying tension or separation of sutures due to some infection or something. Supportive care can usually resolve the problem. Good dressings, taking care of the bag and the device at the same time. It requires combined efforts of the doctor as well as the stoma nurse. And it could eventually lead to stricture and infection. In some cases, you might have to redo the stoma. Infection and fistula. So incidence is again 2 to 14%. Peristomal abscess, infected hematoma might cause it. Treatment would be IND and may require stoma revision in some cases. So what about stoma retraction? It can be one of the most common reasons for a reoperation. Again, tension may be there due to obesity or inadequate taking down of the mesentery. So usually when we take a cut, we have an adequate cut on the mesentery. Can lead to leakage and severe skin problem. Convex stoma plate or use of protective barrier can help if you don't want to intervene, but eventually you might need a revision. Stomal prolapse may occur with parastomal hernia also. Managed by reduction and supportive care until definitive surgery. Surgical management includes reducing the conduit and fixing it again to the sheath. Parastomal hernia, as shown in the picture and depicted in the CT scan down, there would be some predisposing factors like stoma placement lateral to the rectus, which should not be done, large stoma aperture more than required, obesity where the muscle tone is bad, prior abdominal incisions, malnutrition, wound infection. So in minor cases, we can do away with the abdominal binder when the patient does not have any problems putting the appliance or the stoma bag. And in symptomatic cases, we would need repair with a mesh. It can be open or minimally invasive surgery. Skin complications as seen in the photograph, quite a high incidence at times, 3 to 40%, range from mild skin dermatitis to full thickness, skin necrosis and ulceration, skin erosion from constant exposure to stoma effluent. It can be contact dermatitis or fungal infection also. So you need a better fitting appliance, improved cleaning of peristomal skin, application of skin barriers as required, antifungals, antibiotics, and use of stoma paste as required. So video I am keeping in the end. Selecting patients for neobladder. Basic principles of orthotopic urinary diversion. Patients must have an adequate external sphincter mechanism and non-obstructed urethra. Reservoir must be compliant to maintain a low pressure throughout the filling phase. Reservoir must have adequate volume to allow for reasonable voiding intervals. So the capacity should be something like 300 to 500 ml at least. What do we see in an ideal urinary reservoir? So we need a low pressure system. We need functional amount of urine, reliable complete continence, complete voluntary control of voiding, and we don't want absorption of urinary waste products, which go for the side effects or the complications. Selecting neobladder, I have put some oncologic factors. So in men, selecting a neobladder, and what is the risk of urethral recurrence? So primary oncologic contraindication is a positive urethral cut margin at intra-op frozen section. Other factors like carcinoma in situ, multiple tumors, tumors at bladder neck have not found to be independent risk factors. So can this be identified preoperatively? Yes. So we can take a biopsy of prostatic urethra in case of bladder neck tumors when bladder carcinoma in situ is present or when there is positive cytology without evidence of tumor in bladder. And then we can, in men with a negative prostatic urethral biopsy, subsequent orthotopic neobladder construction on after an intra-op frozen section can be avoided. So once we have a negative biopsy, we don't have to do an intra-op frozen section. In men with prior positive transurethral prostatic biopsy, subsequent orthotopic neobladder should not be denied. We can do an intraoperative frozen section of the distal urethral stump, and then if it is negative, can still go ahead with it. So it gives us a good chance of actually doing a neobladder by doing a urethral apex margin frozen section. What about risk of urethral recurrence in women? So tumor at the bladder neck was found to be a high risk factor in the urethra in women. However, about half of the patients with a bladder neck tumor do not have a urethral tumor. So another important concern is a T4A disease, that is involvement of entry vaginal wall. The only factor which decides whether a NB can be performed or not is intra frozen section analysis of proximal urethra. In locally advanced tumor or stage, what can be done? So in clinical T3, T4A, N+, initial concerns were there about doing a neobladder due to advanced disease. However, data has shown that nearly half of the patients with T3, 4A and 30% of PN+ don't have any recurrence at 5 years. The remaining might have. Also, it is seen that most patients with local recurrence can expect normal neobladder function. Now we know that if there is local recurrence, the life or the survival will be shortened, but then the neobladder function doesn't matter. Moreover, adjuvant salvage pelvic radiotherapy is also being used for patients with neobladders with acceptable toxicity profile. So a locally advanced primary tumor should not preclude creation of a neobladder. Selecting patient factors, age. So physiological age is more important than the chronological age. Elderly patients may take longer time to regain continence, renal function. This is one important consideration. Compromised renal function is a contraindication. Urinary electrolytes are reabsorbed. Metabolic acidosis may happen in this case. A creatinine level of more than 1.6 or eGFR less than 40 is a contraindication for neobladder diversion. Obesity is not a contraindication, although a short mesentery sometimes may not allow us to get the bowel so down to have the urethroileal anastomosis. In fact, even creation of a conduit may be difficult in this patient. So in some cases, if you mobilize the mesentery enough, a neobladder may be possible. Manual dexterity. About 30 to 50% patients need to do clean intermittent self-catheterization, at least at one time in 24 hours. So patients need to be taught preoperatively. They may be apprehensive initially, but usually accept it. Urethral stricture disease is a contraindication. Prior pelvic radiation, any reconstruction using bowel can have increased complications when irradiated bowel is used, not a definite contraindication. So if you see, summarize these, absolute contraindication is a GFR less than 40 or creatinine more than 1.6, positive prostatic apical margin on frozen in males, proximal urethral margin frozen of the urethra in females, urethral stricture disease, and the relative would be advanced age, locally advanced disease. Technical considerations in a neobladder. We have discussed the choice of bowel segments. So stomach, ileum, colon, all have been used historically. And what we use most commonly today is detubularized ileum and colon. So greatest compliance is with ileum and next to that of colon. Colonic compliance is hampered by the tinea. Distal bowel mesentery also has more mobility. ileal mucosa also atrophies much more over time and it is more better. So there is decreased mucus production, there is decreased absorption of urinary electrolytes. You are all familiar with this Laplace's law, which would be very important in deciding the physical dynamics of a neobladder and how we give a volume and a shape. So the volume pressure relationship depends on the configuration of the bowel. The aim is to create a reservoir which will hold maximum volume at low pressure so that the upper tracts are protected. Laplace's law states that tension equal to pressure into radius, which is taken into consideration when we take a segment of bowel length. So for a given surface tension, a container with the greater radius will hold larger volumes at lower pressure. The aim is also to create a spherical reservoir as a sphere offers maximum volume for a given surface area. If you see the length, 30, 40, 60 centimeters of what we create from ileum, the volume goes 300, 500 and 900. So this is what explains what we were talking just a while back. Detubularization, splitting the bowel along its anti-mesenteric border, there is discoordination of the motor activity of the bowel. This causes less rise in the intraluminal pressure. However, these coordinated pressure rises return within 6 to 12 months and their effect on the upper tracts is not so well established. So detubularization is what happens like this. And we take a ewer, this is the posterior plate many times and this is how we suture. So coming now to the next topic, subtopic, types of neobladder. So most commonly what we would have is a Studer pouch, and many people would develop a little bit of a modification which would be something called as a modified Studer pouch. But coming to this class, Studer pouch. So 60 centimeters of distal ileum is isolated as shown in this diagrammatic picture, 45 for the pouch, approximately 15 for the chimney. Bowel continuity is restored as we spoke here, the mesentery and the bowel. The 45 segment is detubularized for a pouch. Uretroileal anastomosis is performed by Bricker's technique. The medial borders of the detubularized 45 centimeter are then anastomosed to form the posterior wall as you see here. The spherical, if you see gradually, it is going to get a spherical configuration, is achieved by the folding it in a direction perpendicular to which it was opened. And then after closing half of the anterior wall, the most caudal, as you see here with the finger, part of the neobladder is determined for a urethral anastomosis. Urethral anastomosis. So a complete Studer pouch looks like this. A spherical chimney, ureters, and here is the anastomosis. T-pouch modification of Studer neobladder. Many people do this also. Now there are small variations. Proximal 10 to 15 centimeters of the chimney is disconnected. If you see disconnected, brought here and brought into the pouch, distal 3-4 centimeters of the chimney is anchored into a serosal lined ileal trough formed by the base of two adjacent 22 centimeter ileal segments to form a flap valve like anti-reflex mechanism. Hotman ileal neobladder, commonly also called a W neobladder. A 70 centimeter portion of terminal ileum is selected and detubularized. If you see, this is the area for the urethral anastomosis. Ileum is arranged into a W configuration. A buttonhole of ileum is removed on an anti-mesenteric portion of ileum where urethral anastomosis is performed. Similarly, we have a gonium pouch. The difference is it looks like a W, but the ureters are opened in a specific fashion. The two lateral ileal flaps are joined by seromuscular suture to make backing for the serous lined uretral tunnels. The spatulated ureters are laid into each trough as seen here, and the tunnel is closed over the implanted ureter. The anterior wall of the reservoir is formed by folding the ileum side to side. Similarly, there is an ileocolonic pouch. If you see the ascending colon cecum, ileocolonic pouch, it is again rolled into a spherical thing and the ureters are brought into a looks like a non-refluxing technique, which is slightly easier through the colon. And again, it forms a sphere here. These are stents into the ureter. Sigmoid pouch, neobladder. Again, sigmoid segment is used. Comes again in the form of a pouch. The ureteral stents are brought out in this manner and a urethral anastomosis at this place. So, this is one more neobladder, which is pitcher pot, familiarized and made famous by Dr. Rawal at RGCI. This is the pitcher pot bladder. The most dependent part of the terminal ileum is marked by a suture that helps to take you to the urethra. Distal 40 centimeters ileum is cut at the anti-mesenteric border for detubularization. The incision turns towards the mesenteric border 2 centimeters on either side of the marked suture, thus creating a tongue-like flap out of which a tube will be developed, which will get anastomosed to the urethra. So as to have a tube, which is a small urethra-like thing, and then this part is folded on to join the X point to make a sphere again, and the chimney with the two ureters. So this was a paper published in 2018 by RGCI, voiding patterns in pitcher pot neobladder with 50 patients. And this was a formation of a new urethral tube, as we just discussed. So briefly, the results at 3 months, 13% had daytime incontinence, 60% had nocturnal incontinence, 40% patients were completely dry, 70% patients could void spontaneously, 30% patients required assistance mainly in the form of Valsalva, and 90% developed the sensation kind of to extent of having some desire to void. Advantages was easy to construct. It made things slightly easier, tensionless, urethroileal, rare need of CISC, useful in cases where there is difficulty in bringing down the reservoir, short, like in cases where short ileal mesentery is there. This is a pitcher pot earthenware. And if you see, this is how the neobladder looks. And this is a cystogram where a nice shape and a new urethral tube probably was here, but gradually as the time goes, this neo-urethral tube, it kind of opens up conically like a spherical bladder. So these are the various lengths, just for a quick reference, Studer 60 to 65, Hotman 70, pitcher pot say 55, T-pouch 50, Koch ileal bladder 60, and Abolaina and Gonam 60. So these are roughly, we lose 50 to 70 centimeters of bowel when we plan a neobladder. Post-operative care of a neobladder. We need regular sterile washes with normal saline started around 4 hours after surgery because the mucus secretion starts. These washes are given every 4 to 6 hours in a quite a sterile manner, and interval can be increased or decreased depending on the mucus production which comes back in the return wash. Soda bicarb may be added for a mucolytic effect during the wash with saline. These washes may be taught even to the patient's relative in the little long term. Patient is encouraged to remain well hydrated, so a good amount of urine output is generated. And catheter removal is usually on day 10 to 14. A cystogram may or may not be performed prior to catheter removal. Minimally invasive techniques for a neobladder. So intracorporeal construction has been described. Most commonly described is Studer or modified Studer. Recent evidence is in the form of single center experience with small numbers. Current evidence, intracorporeal reconstruction is feasible, safe, takes a little longer than the open reconstruction. The IROC trial is an ongoing RCT comparing open radical cystectomy and robotic cystectomy with intracorporeal reconstruction. So this would be the first giving comprehensive RCT straight head-to-head comparison. What about refluxing or non-refluxing ureteral anastomosis in a neobladder? So this was published in 2015 by Skinner from, I think, Stanford. So randomized trial of Studer pouch versus T-pouch, orthotopic ileal neobladder. 237 patients with T-pouch, that is non-refluxing, and 247 of Studer, which are refluxing. So patients were allowed for minimum followed for 3 years, and outcome was to check for renal function decline. So if you see the GFR decline of more than 10 ml per minute, both the procedures, refluxing, non-refluxing, were same. Also, the late complications were same. the incidence of UTI also was almost the same. If you see the incidence of urinary divergent-related secondary interventions, slightly higher in the non-refluxing than the refluxing. So here, refluxing remain a little better. Continence with neobladder. Gradual improvement in continence can happen over 6 to 12 months. Around 80 to 90% patients achieve it at 12 months. Predictors of worse continence, age more than 65 and diabetes, non-gynec tract sparing cystectomy in females. So if you retain the uterus, there are a lot of supports which are retained and a posterior support which is better. Non-nerve sparing surgery. Nighttime continence usually takes longer. Around 25 to 50% patients continue to have nighttime incontinence. It results due to decreased sphincter tone in the night, and patients may be advised to wake up in the night 1 to 2 times with an alarm to empty their neobladders. How to manage neobladder incontinence? Pelvic floor muscle training should begin preoperatively, biofeedback, artificial sphincter in males, and maybe use of bulking agents to the urethra in females. Urinary retention, or what is hypercontinence? So 4 to 25% would suffer from hypercontinence. Women suffer more than the men. Presentation is in the form of recurrent UTIs due to residual urine. Overflow incontinence may happen. Rarely acute urinary retention can happen. Okay. Rule out a vasico-urethral anastomotic stricture with a cystoscopy. This is a very rare cause. Specific problem in females. The pouch falls back in the wide pelvis, resulting in a sharp angulation of the neobladder-urethral junction. Management options include transposition of omentum behind the pouch, suspending the vaginal cuff, suspending the pouch anterior to the rectus. Otherwise, commonly also managed with CISC. Surgical complications with a neobladder. Early complications would be urine leak. Incidence is 5%. More common that conduit because of the long suture lines. A high drain serum creatinine ratio can identify a urine leak. What we need is to identify the site of the leak with a CT cystogram. A neobladder urethral anastomosis leak may be there, or a neobladder suture line leak may be there, or a ureteral neobladder anastomosis. So these are the only three places we need to identify that. A small leak may be managed conservatively. Urinary diversion by bilateral PCNs can be done. Pigtailing of intra-abdominal collections, antibiotics, long-term catheter could be used. A large leak or failure of conservative treatment of small leak may necessitate surgical intervention. So resuturing, or at times takedown of the neobladder and bringing the chimney out as a conduit, can be done. Other late complications: urinary infection, asymptomatic colonization of the neobladder is quite common. Symptomatic UTIs are more common than with conduit continent cutaneous divergence. A UTI should prompt an evaluation for ureteric obstruction or incomplete emptying of the neobladder. Ureteroileal anastomotic stricture. Incidence is around 5%, almost similar to that with the conduit. Incidence is higher with non-refluxing. Diagnosis by clinical symptoms of pain, fever, and imaging of hydronephrosis, it can be confirmed with a DTPA scan. Management depends on the length of the stricture. A small segment may be incised endoscopically or managed with regular stent exchange, dilatation. Long segment stricture may need a surgical revision or a lifelong PCN. Stones within the neobladder, common in the earlier pouches, which were made using staplers and colonic pouches, uncommon with the modern day neobladders, unless the patient has chronic incomplete emptying, and management is by endoscopic techniques. Pouch vaginal fistula can happen in 5 to 10%. Prevention techniques: leave the anterior vaginal wall intact if oncologically safe. Watertight closure of vaginal cuff, omental interposition could be used. Diagnosis is via cystogram. Repair may be transvaginal or transabdominal. Difficult at times, may require conversion to a conduit. So video comes in the end. Another divergent which is commonly used is a continent cutaneous urinary divergent. Rarely performed today. were originally described as continent alternative to ileal conduit. All continent cutaneous divergence need intermittent catheterization. Patient must be able to care for himself or herself. A continent cutaneous pouch will absorb urine also. So all preoperative metabolic considerations of a neobladder are applicable here. Common sites for cutaneous stoma is either suprapubic in females or umbilicus or sometimes in the right iliac fossa. How is continence achieved? Using the appendix and tunneling it under the cecal tinea, using tapered terminal ileum and making use of ileal cecal valve as in Indiana pouch, intussusception of an ileal segment into the adjacent segment to create a valve effect. This is a mains pouch, which is a continuous cutaneous divergent. Slightly complicated, done by very few people. 10 to 15 centimeter portion of cecum and ascending colon is isolated along with two separate equal size limbs of distal ileum and an additional portion of ileum measuring 20 centimeters. The intact ileum is intussuscepted and two rows of staples are taken on the intussusception itself. The intussuscipience is led through the intact IC valve and a third row of staples is taken to stabilize the nipple valve to the ileocecal valve. It's quite a complex procedure. All this is done to achieve that continence. A button of skin is removed from the depth of umbilical funnel and an ileal terminus is directed through this button hole. Indiana pouch. So again, ileocecal segment. Ileocecal segment is used, a terminal ileum approximately 10 centimeters, appendectomy is performed, entire right colon is opened along its antimesenteric border, interrupted Lambert sutures are taken over a short distance 3 to 4 centimeters in two rows for a double imbrication of ileocecal valve and application of opposing Lambert sutures on each side of the terminal ileum. So if you see, this forms a pouch, the ureters would come somewhere here and we would have this going out as a catheterizable stoma. Excess part of the ileum is cut, which is antimesenteric. Sigmoid pouch, again a similar type of a pouch with ureters coming posteriorly. Long-term complications with continent divergence. So what we see is electrolyte abnormalities. These occur primarily due to absorption of urine across intestinal segment. Depend on which segment of bowel is used, surface area of contact with urine, contact time of urine with bowel and native renal function. So bowel segments used for divergence, stomach, which is rarely used today, causes hypochloremia, hypokalemia, metabolic alkalosis, jejunum, hyperkalemia, hypochloremia and metabolic acidosis. Ileum colon, quite safer, causing hyperchloremia and metabolic acidosis. Serum creatinine levels need not necessarily reflect renal functions. We might need many other levels like serum bicarb or many others. Other long-term complications, stones within the divergent due to staples or nidus of bowel mucosa with infection, osteomalacia related to acidosis, vitamin B12 malabsorption in neobladders because a long segment of ileum gets out, cancer, 6% with ureterosigmoidostomy at 10 years and short gut syndrome. Coming to cutaneous ureterostomy, simplest form of urinary divergent where you just get out the ureter onto the skin. Less operative time, complication rate is slightly lesser, but some complications like stenosis can happen. Length of hospital stay is reduced. Bowel complications are essentially nullified as we don't touch the bowel. It may be preferred divergent in old and frail patients, especially when they have a solitary functioning kidney. But words of caution here, for a young, fit patient, even if there is a solitary kidney, please consider creating an ileal conduit by implanting the single ureter rather than a cutaneous ureterostomy to avoid the long-term complication of stenosis and some complications of infection. QOL parameters are quite comparable. So this is how you make an incision, bring out the ureter, spatulate it and evert it. A small pouch for the ureter. Complications are necrosis of the ureter. Ureter is brought out from the retroperitoneum onto the anterior abdominal wall, can cause some tension onto the ureter leading to compromised vascularity. It has also been suggested to bring out ureter on the lateral abdominal wall to prevent this. Stomal stenosis can occur. Stenosis is much more common than the conduit, possible because of the inherently small diameter of the ureter. Maintaining a stent for prolonged periods has been suggested and used successfully. Ascending UTIs are also more common because there is a very short segment directly leading to the renal system, pelvic lesion. So coming to the quality of life issues with related to divergence. This is a 2019 publication which studied health-related quality of life related to urinary diversion in radical cystectomy, a systematic review. Cystectomy is a major surgery and urinary diversion has a negative impact on quality of life. This is what we think. So this parameter assesses the impact of the disease and its treatment on the patient as perceived by the patient. Various QOL questionnaires were used. Some of them are applicable to all cancers and not bladder cancer specific. So basically, these were 11 studies with around 1400 patients, including 730 neobladders and 659 ileal conduits. Mean age in conduits was 68.5 and neobladders was 61.6. Two studies had more neobladders, three studies had more ileal conduits, and six had no great difference. So there was no definite evidence of superiority of one diversion over the other. Most studies reported that quality of life progressively increased with time in both. It was important to discuss with patients and families the challenges presented by various diversions and involve them in the decision making. So if we set accurate pre-op expectations, patient will be more content with their post-op condition. How to select patients for a urinary diversion and their counseling. So this is a 2009 publication, slightly old, but role of patient-physician dialogue in selecting the type of urinary diversion. It highlights and tells us that a patient-physician dialogue is very important. So when an IC was suggested, over 80% accepted. When both were offered, younger patients usually elected a neobladder and older patients preferred an ileal conduit. So it is important to recognize any definite contraindication as we had discussed in the earlier part of the talk. There would be some definite contraindications for a particular procedure and then not to offer that to a particular patient. When offering a particular diversion, discuss all pros and cons with the patient. So nothing can replace the native bladder. We don't get that sensation absolutely perfectly even in 2021. The aim of urinary tract reconstruction is to create a new urinary system as close to the normal physiological system as possible. So thank you. And I think I'll come to the videos. So coming to the ileal conduit, is the video playing?
No, not yet. You can stop sharing this. You have okay. Video in this file only, or
no, sir? I think yeah. I'll stop share and play yeah. Sir. 1 minute. Give me 20 seconds.
No issues.
Is it seen now?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is ileal conduit. This was a 50 years female housewife. Basically, the diagnosis was CT3N1M0 urothelial bladder cancer. And plan was radical cystectomy with ileal conduit. The video starts after the cystectomy part. So this is the cecum. We are isolating the bowel segment. The last part of the terminal ileum around 15 centimeters we usually leave because there is a major blood vessel down there. And conduit length further from the marking should be usually 15 to 20 centimeters. We can tailor it according to the patient's bowel body habitus. We have to ensure a good, well vascularized segment. We do use staplers, but you can use a Hansoon anastomosis also. So that is the length of the conduit. And the next procedure is we ensure the continuity of the bowel. So this is a stapled anastomosis. Can be done by hand also. Usually, we try to use NTLC GI staplers. And these are the sutures where the stapler was introduced with a 4-0 PDS. The mesentery is closed off. The bowel segment is down. The transposition of the left ureter. The left ureter has to come below the sigmoid tunnel and then we spatulate it. Usually the dog ears are cut because we don't want to take chance of any leaks or anything. Usually when you cut that, you can see that the edges are healthy. After doing the anastomosis, so we put saline into the segment and mark the site. This is for the left one, Bricker's technique. People use 3-0, 4-0. We use 5-0 double arm currently and do a continuous anastomosis. Many people would do an intermittent, but continuous does well with respect to leaks or anything. There was a reported early problem that it may lead to stenosis, but with very optimal and adequate spatulation, we have not seen stenosis in a continuous suturing done in a continuous fashion. So this would be classical Bricker's technique. When we are doing this part of the procedure, usually we should relax all the other retractors and let the rectus muscle also rest a little. So we do put an infant feeding tube into the ureter and then close the other side. So the infant feeding tube is passed from the distal end at the junction where the ureteral ileal anastomosis is happening after one layer is sutured and then going into the left. So you check lie again of the right ureter and repeat the process of spatulation. This is the angle suturing and again a Bricker's technique. See, the ureter is well vascularized. There is a very good peri-adventitial tissue there if you see this video. And the edges have to be approximated nicely. Again, the infant feeding tube is passed. Some people use long single J stents, so that is also acceptable. We usually fix or anchor the infant feeding tubes at the mouth of the mouth or the stoma at the distal end. So this is how both the ureters would go and the conduit will fall here. They are both posteriorly. Later on, we can check by putting saline if there is any leak even here. So you distend and then come to the part of stoma creation. So as we had discussed, marking of the stoma, it should be within the rectus muscle on the spino-umbilical line. You cut the rectus sheath. Either cut a small section or make it cruciate. I had written there 2 fingers, but it should be adequate enough for the bowel and the mesentery to come out. Again, not too loose, not too tight. So conduit mesentery goes well at 2 o'clock because the lie goes like that. And these are sutures with the sheath, seromuscular, which will anchor the stoma and not let it go down. So complications which I had shown, like retraction or are lesser. So this happens in all the 4 directions. This is the mesentery side I had seen. So we would avoid a stitch directly into the mesentery because the distal part is vascularized because of this mesentery, which supplies to this area. Both the stents are seen with catgut. They are just anchored here. And this is how a small pouting stoma is there, finally formed. When we pull this skin to the incision side, this will all get flat. That's the urine coming out, adequate number of stitches. What remains is lateralization. That is, you take sutures from the conduit seromuscular to the lateral peritoneum so that there is no internal herniation. So that's a ileostoma or Dr. a Dinesh, urostoma.
Dr. Dinesh, call. Sorry to interrupt.
Yes,
Dr.
sir.
Dinesh, sorry. There's a question in the chat box, which I wanted to show from your video. How you re-peritonize the ileal conduit? That was a question from Kaushal. If you can show that step again in your video. Okay. Yeah.
So I think, Kaushal, that step is not very clear in the video. What was very clear was lateralization. But what happens is, I'll explain you verbally. What happens is, I'll take back to a step where it was shown. 1 minute, I'll take you a little back. Okay, if you come to this step, so here the anastomosis is done. Slightly back. Okay, if you see this step, now the anastomosis is done and both the ureters are like this. So we flip this down and there will be a peritoneal covering at the side on the sigmoid mesentery. So I don't know whether I'll see a sigmoid mesentery in this clip, but if I put it here, there will be a sigmoid here. You can see this is the tinea. And this sigmoid has a mesentery on this side. So once this conduit falls down, the mesentery of the sigmoid covers the distal part of this conduit. So this mesentery will cover this whole part. This conduit falls down. Here is the mesentery. So that is called retroperitonealization. What is shown much ahead here is a lateralization. So that prevents an internal hernia. 1 minute, it's moving too fast. So this is lateralization. So what can make a difference? There are few tips here which could make a difference. Having a stoma care unit who would look after all these things, a surgery done or the best possible position or a very fatty abdomen. And complications following continuous and interrupted. So half of the leaks required re-exploration, all strictures required re-exploration. So if you see these statistics, this was in our own patients. So in the interrupted, there were 6% leaks, in the continuous 1.8%. And the stricture rate was less in interrupted, slightly more in our early experience in continuous, but with good spatulation, there is no stricture rate actually. Going ahead, there are a few more tips to do this. When you dissect a ureter, it's best to take a good amount of periuretral tissue, which carries all the vascular supply with it. If you skeletonize the ureters, then chances of ischemia, chances of having uretroileal leaks also may happen, and stenosis. Another is use of indocyanine green to minimize ureteroenteric strictures. So it is said that a significant reduction in anastomotic strictures has happened with the use of indocyanine green. So if you see, this ureter has it till the end and the other ureter has distal 2 centimeters or 1.5 centimeters not showing vascularity. So we need to cut this here. I think we need to go back to the next video. Coming to the share again. Okay. So this is about modified Studer new bladder. Again, this is a CT2N0M0 urothelial bladder cancer, and the plan was a modified Studer technique. 15 to 20 centimeters of the initial bowel, distal bowel is left and a mark is made. So these are diagrammatic from the BJUI. This is how the segment is taken. Usually we measure the thread on a ruler, and 40 plus 15, we have slightly modified this technique. So that's why we call it modified Studer. The proximal end is marked here. The proximal most end was the chimney. Again, you take care of the mesentery. We tie off this, or sometimes you can use a vessel sealer nowadays. Usually when you are planning the neobladder, the mesenteric cuts need to be adequately longer and also safe. They should provide vascularity to the whole big segment. The distal cut needs to be a slightly more longer than the proximal. As earlier, we would restore the bowel continuity. We just assess the reach to the urethra because we do not want any surprises. So this is the chimney and the two limbs with a seromuscular stitch just aligned to each other. So you know that that is the chimney and this is going to form the pouch. The pouch is detubularized. The posterior plate is formed, suturing in the seromuscular layers. So generally we use a 2O or a 3O Vicryl. We have also used 3O PDS in this kind of suturing. If you see, this is bringing the left ureter below the tunnel. The left ureter is aligned. I've just stopped the video. If you see, this is again the sigmoid. And then there is a mesentery here. You see the left ureter coming out of this. So this was the peritoneum which I wanted to show in the ileal conduit video. So this peritoneum covers the distal end of the ileal conduit and the ureters are posteriorly. So as it, this part of the peritoneum of the sigmoid mesentery covers the ileal conduit, it is called retroperitonealization. So going ahead with this neobladder video, this is the left ureter below the sigmoid tunnel. Adequately freshened, you may choose to do a ICG or check the vascularity of the ureter. So this is again Bricker's technique. The left ureter we usually do first, but there is no hard fast rule. Both need to be well aligned. There should be no twist in the ureter. And then the Bricker's type of ureteroileal anastomosis. After one wall is continuously anastomosed, we do try to get in a stent through the neobladder and would, it will shortly come. So this is the stent which is coming from the chimney. We are taking in the stent from the mesentery, getting it in the neobladder first pouch, and then it would go through the chimney into the ureter, left. And then the wall of the, this is the fixing of the stent in the neobladder with a chromic catgut, and usually by day 7 to 10, they easily come out. Very rarely we have pulled and they have not come out. So that is how the left ureter would go on the chimney. After finishing the left, we turn to the right. We do this step of putting periuretral fat to the seromuscular ileum just to cover the inner layer. That is how you have checked the left ureter. There is no leak here. The site for the right one, a little bit in the front. So after completion of both the ureters, a slight folding of the neobladder. And then again checking the reach. So this is the urethral end which is marked, and again the reach is checked here. It goes easily to the urethra. So classically, Studer would have a buttonhole, but we are not doing that. We are doing something like a mix for a neo-urethral anastomosis. And we do this continuous with a 2-0 monocryl suture 5-8 circle. So if you see, there is a bougie in the urethra, just to identify, there is a good length of urethra seen here. We have marked the site on the ileal plate. This is the 6 o'clock suture. These are being taken in a continuous fashion. It may be slightly difficult to understand it, but what we are essentially doing is, in a continuous fashion, we are taking the urethra from posterior 3 to 9 o'clock and the posterior plate of the urethra from the bladder side. So this is what we have pulled, putting the catheter, and it comes on the posterior plate. There is the yellow catheter there. Continuing with a separate suture again from 9 o'clock to 3 o'clock. So a small tripointer would come here at 12 o'clock position. As you see now, there is a urethra and these are the ileal plates going in. So when we are going to pull the continuous suture, everything is going to oppose and form an anastomosis. So that is the pull. And this is the anastomosis, and this is we have to suture to form the anterior wall. Now we'll suture to make the anterior wall. So now what we do is to finally form a spherical pouch. This is a small part of the anterior wall suturing, and there would be a spherical pouch made. There would be one more tripointer at the end. So the suture used here, we have used, I think, 30 PDS. Earlier we were using 2-0 Vicryl, but we feel good knotting properties with the 3-0 PDS. So this is the folded arm here. It's open still now, and we are suturing at two places. As you see, a round spherical thing has formed here. When you are doing a neobladder, you have to be very patient, have a good stamina, and not lose it. It eventually looks like this, but the neo-urethral suturing was different. You put a catheter and usually check if there is any leak. We bring out the stents outside actually. We don't leave them inside since we use infant feeding tubes. And usually we should use the shortest distance from where we have got out the stents from this mesentery. to the skin. We keep them open in the post-op period so that less urine goes down. We use the catheter for the washes to be given. But because of the continuous nature of suturing technique, usually well optimized patients preoperatively, things go well. Okay, so this is the this video will get over in 4 minutes. It is a cutaneous ureterostomy. So a left nephrourethrectomy was also done because the left kidney had 5% renal function. And what happens is then we, the means to do surveillance about the left ureter and left kidney are very difficult. So generally going fast about it, the ureterostomy should be marked outside the rectus, because the rectus will close the ureter. So there is a right ureter. These are the vessels. This is the clean area. We mark just outside. So I would say that we should mark it outside in an anterior axillary line. A smiley incision is better. This is a cutting current of the cautery. You go straight vertical deep because you don't want a very thin skin flap which would necrose. You want that small skin flap with all the possible dermal fat, subdermal fat, so that it retains its subcuticular.
Sir, I think we should have the video played again. There is some problem in the video.
Okay. Is it visible?
No, sir, not yet.
Okay. I'll stop share and start then, because this was sharing actually.
Yes, sir.
Is it visible?
Visible now.
Okay. So I'll slightly go faster for the initial step because it is nearing 8:20. The rectus muscle is marked, and we would have the ileal conduit here actually. And in this, we go lateral to that thing. We are just shown the incision, which is a half semicircle or a smiley. The right ureter is like this after a left nephrourethrectomy. And as I said, we would normally do it in frail patients. So you go beyond, and ideally you go to the anterior axillary line well away, so that even the right ureter or the ureter which side you are doing does not have any weight or any pressure from the bowel. So the ureter lie should be absolutely laterally to have a good result. The incision is deepened directly vertically, either with a knife or with a cutting current cautery, the shortest possible distance inside. The ureter, again, the lie should be checked. It should be got out, cut with an adequate length. So you cut an adequate length, whichever you feel. Spatulate. Slightly invert it. So fine sutures are better always. This is the angle suture. Angle of the spatulated ureter and apex of the smiley. So the skin flap going a little inside helps to prevent stricture only. We insert an infant feeding tube again, which can be retained even for 15 days. So a skin flap is down here. A periadventitial stitch so that it remains firm. This is a 5-0 needle, so very small, sharp needle. And since the ureter actually comes very laterally, it doesn't require any lateralization or something. So I think that's the end, sir. I mean, these were the three procedures. It's almost 8:20.
Yeah. Can you take a few questions, Dr. Dinesh?
Yes, sir. Sure. Sir.
One question was there that during the ileal conduit, whether you can make the stoma first and then make the uretroileal anastomosis.
So it is always better to do the uretroileal anastomosis because, you know, ureters many times have very small caliber. And stoma can always be brought out at slightly different places as per our convenience. Usually the site is fixed, but I think ureter is the more delicate procedure that I would say in that manner.
Okay.
Check the chat.
Yeah, another question is your recommendation on the bowel preparation, both mechanical and antibiotic prophylaxis.
So today we actually take a good history of the patient if the patient is constipated. If the patient is not constipated, then very honestly, today we don't give a very great bowel preparation. This is recommended and done all over the world nowadays, and even in the ERAS guidelines, it is done. Long back, when I was here in 2009, when I joined, and when I was a fellow much earlier in 2004-05, we used to give Peglec to the patient, but that practice is given up totally. In between, we used to give a very small quantity of Exhalite up to 2015-16. And after that, we have stopped giving any bowel preparation. So we do a intraoperative wash to the conduit and even to the even in a neobladder.
Okay. A few more questions, if it's okay with you.
Can yes, I go sir, ahead? All. Yes, sir, please. I am just looking for
In your practice, we do see the indication of stomach and duodenum being used as the conduits. You find any indication of stomach and duodenum being used in current era?
Sir, no. Because practically for the last 10 years, I have never used. Before that, we have once done an ileocolonic. So stomach and jejunum never, sir.
Okay.
So I think personally, ileum is the best.
Okay. Let us assume we have got a case who has got radiation to the pelvis, indication CA cervix or something, and we need to do ileal conduit is an option for say upper tract changes with the mild renal failure. So what are the changes you find when you do ileal conduit? What you should be doing?
So, as a cancer center, we do get these scenarios a little more commonly than the other institutes, probably radiated colorectal or gynec patients. And what we do is depends. We may be needing to do a simple cystectomy first because usually it is radiation cystitis or something. And many of the older machines of radiation were very bad, cobalt 60. Nowadays they have IGRTs and less side effects. What happens is the bowel is very sometimes thick. It is sometimes hyperemic. And what we do is we try to select a slightly proximal segment for a conduit. As I said in the video and theory, 10-15 centimeters is left from the IC junction. So here you can literally check and go to a better segment, leave 25-30 centimeters and take a segment of the slightly proximal or the mid ileum, which will be a little bit protected from the radiation effect, and use that. Do all your techniques very safely. today when ICG is available, I would say use ICG and check the ureters also, because the lower end of the ureters also hit with the radiation, causing radiation related ureteric thrombosis or other changes. And then after essential freshening or cutting of the ureters, you can use the most supple vascular ureters to do the conduit.
Dr. Ganesh, let us assume we have a patient who's very obese and you're trying to do conduit. The conduit is not coming. What do you do with this short mesentery and very obese patients? What are the tricks for doing the allele conduit?
Okay, so very short mesentery, what we can do is instead of the usual 15 centimeters, we can have a slightly longer conduit. That is one thing. Secondly, we can see on table if by keeping the distal cut on the mesentery a little longer than the proximal cut. So sometimes that might still help us, a distal cut keeping longer. In the last resort, you can relocate the site of the conduit. And in some patients, as I was talking, very rarely, I mean, in some patients, you will feel that a neobladder and conduit both are equally difficult. So if by chance, if you can follow something like a pitcher pot neobladder, it gives a additional 3-4 centimeters of a urethral tube. So sometimes that might be your call.
Dr. Ganesh, another question. Supposing you have a situation where the bowel as well as the urine diversion has to take place. So what do you do in these circumstances? You make two stoma or you have a different way of managing with the one stoma? What do you do?
So, sir, we do different stomas. So in case we have to do a total excentration and two stomas, then we would get the ureteral urostoma on the regular side, right side, and try to put the bowel stoma on the left side.
Okay.
Okay. So usually these patients would have a good survival. I'm talking about cancer patients here. And if you sometimes then know that the patient does not have a very great survival, then you might explore that possibility in, you know, some circumstances that you bring out a bowel stoma and put the ureter to that. But that is very rare.
Okay. I'll have two more questions. This come now only in the chat box. Your comment on LVMPAM for bowel movement, and why do you prefer a bigger type of anastomosis, and your follow-up for new bladder?
So the Alvimopan is not available here. So we also have seen the use in Western countries and in books. Why do we prefer Bricker technique? Because over the years, it has been seen why refluxing or non-refluxing basically, because in refluxing, the upper tracts might get damaged. That was the major concern. So non-refluxing means no urine goes up basically and causes any kind of pyelonephritis. But in the refluxing ones, it has been seen in adult life, at least no great damage has been happening. What we over the years get is a slight passive dilatation of the ureters, which is okay. There is no great decline in renal function. Do you routinely... Sir, last question was...
Your follow-up protocol for new bladder.
Okay, new bladder. So follow-up protocol would depend. In the first year, we would assess 3 monthly. We do imaging. Okay, we do CBC renal functions. Urine cytology is done because we still have the upper tracts and the urethra. If suspicious or if patient gives any history, then we would do a urethroscopy. Per se, scopy of the neobladder is not essential. The ureters are, if suspicious, checked via a CT IVU imaging. And otherwise, CT would be required 6 monthly. After 2 years, the imaging, if patient is stable, would be relaxed.
Dr. Ganesh, final question. This is from Dr. Lakshman Prabhu. He has asked, is neobladder a diversion? It is at best an interposition of bowel. If neobladder is a diversion, then ileal replacement of uterus should also be called diversion. Your comments on that.
Is neobladder a diversion?
Yeah. What he is telling is, it's just like a interposition of bowel between the two ends of urinary tract, one the ureter at one end and the ureter at
I agree with Dr. Lakshman Prabhu that conceptually he is right. I mean, we all know the techniques and everything of neobladder. So I mean, he's right. I don't want to answer it otherwise. But getting that bowel into that interposition is a big, big trouble and a big effort. It does take a lot of suturing. Otherwise, a tailor would do.
Thank you, Dr. Ganesh. That was all from the chat box.
Thank you, sir.
Over to you, Dr. Keshav now.
Thank you, Dr. Ganesh, for your time. It was a wonderful lecture. We had mixed
Thank
up
you,
good
sir.
Videos, good teaching videos, and a vast topic you were able to cover in the given time. It was a very good, you entirely covered all the types of diversion and the complications, all those things very nicely. I hope the residents would have benefited with it. And on behalf of us, thank you very much for your time. And we will ask you to come in for some more topics in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
Rajiv. Over to Dr.
Rajiv.
Is Dr. Rajiv there?
He's there. No, we'll wind up. Close up with again. Yeah. Thanks, Dr. Ganesh, and thanks all the viewers. I think I got just now a message from Dr. Lakshman Prabhu and many faculty for your excellent presentation. Beautiful.
Thank you, sir.
Very nicely presented. Dr. Sood?
Sorry.
We are almost going. Yeah.
So it was in between. I was watching it and I had a commitment on the other news channel also. So I'm sorry, I was disconnected in between. Thank you, Dr. Ganesh, for this wonderful lecture and all the operations, operative procedure, the way you have explained and with all the videos, incorporated the steps and all residents are going to be immensely benefited. Thank you very much, and thanks all the residents, the office staff, and we will continue our labs of distant accordingly. And with this, back to Dr. Arun Chawla.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Ganesh. Excellent presentation, excellent videos. Thanks. All the residents, thank you, the faculty, thank you, all the USA members and the members from other international organizations. Thank you very much. We'll sign off, sir. Stay safe, stay well.